Okay, you've made it through three quarters of this course, and you're ready for the denouement, the last part of the course, the last three chapters, 12, 13, and 14. And to start off chapter 12, we're actually going to introduce something that we've already introduced earlier, which is that the concept of torque. But we're going to use it in a very mathematical sense here for calculations. And what you're going to learn today, though simple as it may be, is going to be very important for future courses to come. It's going to be an integral part of a statics course yet to come. It'll probably take you about halfway through a statics course, if you can understand it well. So consider this. Recall that torque is described by a radius vector to a point crossed with the force vector at that point. So as we're looking at this diagram here, we have a radial vector going to this point and extending along that line. Then we have a force at that point. And if I were to employ the right-hand rule for cross products, point my fingers in the direction of the first vector, which is R, and then close it through the smallest angle possible to the second vector, F, then my thumb would be pointing out towards you. And hence, this torque would be in the positive z direction towards you, at least for this diagram here. So the direction of the torque is defined by this right-hand rule for cross products. And that torque vector would be out towards you. And in a sense, I have another right-hand rule that if I point my thumb in the direction of the torque vector, my curled fingers represent the direction of the rotation of the object. So either of those right-hand rules will work, cross product or rotation, because we can see if we had a force on this object, it would rotate this way, and that rotation would again be indicated by torque vector in the positive z direction, perpendicular to the actual plane of the rotational motion. But we also said earlier that torque is equal to the force times its moment arm. And if we have a force and we define its line of action, that the torque is equal to the force times the moment arm, where the moment arm is the shortest distance to that line of action. So it's force times d. So I have this force F. I have a line of action which goes infinitely long along its length. And then the shortest distance is this distance d from the axis to that line. And if I look at this right triangle here, the magnitude r being the hypotenuse of that right triangle, then d is going to be equal to r sine theta, because theta is going to be the same angle on both sides of these intersecting lines. So d is r sine theta, and I can see that my torque will have the same magnitude as the previous screen. It's going to be F times R sine theta, or F times D. And the direction of the torque, again, would be given by the right-hand rule, or the direction of the rotation, which is counterclockwise, is going to give you a torque vector coming out towards you. But my emphasis here is, if you can start seeing torques in this way, as forces with a line of action, and then the moment arm being the shortest distance to that line of action, and torque is the force times that moment arm, if you can see that, it'll take you a long way towards understanding statics. Here's a situation where we have two forces acting on an object, and they're equal and opposite, so the net force on this object is zero. However, defined from some origin here, they each have a different moment arm, and hence there is going to be a net torque on this object. This force that is further away from that origin is going to have a longer moment arm, and hence it's going to have a larger torque than the other force. Hence we're going to end up with a net torque that actually is forcing this thing to go clockwise, and the direction of that torque then would be into the page. So as you're looking at the tail feathers of the X, as the torque vector is going into the page. But this kind of situation where you have force equilibrium, equal and opposite forces, but you don't have torque equilibrium because there are not equal and opposite torques is called a couple. You have two forces equal and opposite, but there is a net torque causing a rotation of the object, but not necessarily a translation of the object. Well, that brings up one of our cases for equilibrium. An object subjected to two forces is in equilibrium if and only if the two forces are equal in magnitude, opposite in direction, so they have a net force of zero, and that they have the same line of action. Hence, they would have a net torque of zero. So we have force equilibrium satisfied, and if they have the same line of action, they have the same moment arm, and hence torque equilibrium would be satisfied because one torque one direction will equal the same magnitude torque in the other direction. So both conditions of equilibrium would be satisfied, hence it would truly be a static situation. Here's case two. If an object is subjected to three forces to be in equilibrium, the lines of action of the three forces must intersect at a common point. So for this object to be in equilibrium, being acted on by exactly three forces, somewhere the lines of action of those three forces must intersect at a common point. When this happens, we say that these forces are concurrent, that they intersect at the common point. So we have two conditions for static equilibrium. The net force on the object must be zero in any direction we choose, x, y, z, or any arbitrary direction. Add up all the forces, must equal zero. There's no translation. The net torque on the object must be zero by any origin. If the object is truly static, then not only is it not translating, it is not rotating either. If it's not rotating, then the net torque on the object must be zero. Now, if it's not rotating and the net torque is zero, that must be true about any origin we choose. Not just an origin in the center or origin on the side, any origin. If it's not rotating at all, then no matter what origin we choose to calculate the torques, they must add up to zero because it's not rotating. And that gives you a very powerful tool. Most problems can be reduced to looking only at equilibrium in the xy plane. Hence, the sum of all the forces in the x direction would be zero. The sum of all the forces in the y direction would be zero, just like what we've done before with our dynamics. But now we have an added equation. The sum of the torques about an axis, the axis being in the z direction, would be equal to zero. Even though the rotation will be in the xy plane, our torques are either positive z or negative z for xy rotations. If the object is not rotating, then the net torque about any axis in space will add up to zero. This is truly a beautiful situation because if I can choose the axis that I calculate my torques, I can choose an axis that will eliminate certain forces from the equation. In other words, if I can choose an axis which has the lines of actions of forces going through that axis, then those forces will have no moment arms, zero distance to their line of actions, and hence they will have no torque about that origin. That will simplify the problem immensely as far as doing the mathematics, if I can eliminate certain torques from consideration. So I have the option of choosing any axis I wish. I'm going to choose the one that has the most forces, the most line of actions of forces going through that point. And then I can eliminate those torques from consideration. So here's our problem-solving strategy. We're going to choose a convenient coordinate system, draw a free body diagram, and label all the external forces acting on the object, just like what we've done before in Chapter 5. Resolve all the forces into components, x and y. Sum up all the forces to be zero. And then sum up all the torques to be zero. Now, in this last situation, we'll choose an axis that will simplify the calculation. An axis chosen at the contact points of several forces will eliminate those forces from torque consideration, since their moment arms will be zero. And it doesn't even have to be the contact points. If the line of actions of the force go through that point, then they will be eliminated from torque consideration. For instance, if I had a force over here, and its line of action was going through this axis over here, well, all it's doing is just pushing on that axis. It's not causing a rotation either this way or that way. So there is no torque by a force that's going radially into that origin, that point where the pivot is. Once we set this up, then we'll solve for the unknowns. Let's try this out. Here's a problem. A uniform semicircular sign, 1 meter in diameter and of weight 100 newtons, is supported by two wires as shown. What is the tension in the two wires supporting the sign? So we have a semicircular sign of a reputable business, Goldman's Superconductors, and we have two cords, and the tension in those cords must be along the length of the cords. This sign must have weight and must be acting at its center of mass, which I don't really know where that is. But I do know that the center of mass would be symmetric, at least in the x direction, so it's going to be right in the middle of the sign as far as x is concerned. I don't know about the y direction because it's not symmetric in the y direction. So it's somewhere along this vertical line that splits us down the middle, but I don't know exactly where it is. It's not going to matter. If we did a torque equilibrium diagram, we could indicate where all the forces are acting and their moment arms about some point, in this case, point A. So we have tension 1 over here at point A, tension 2, which is 0.75 meters away, and then I have this weight force, which has a moment arm of 0.5 meters. Now, again, I don't know where on that vertical line the weight is acting, but I know its line of action is vertical, and the distance from the point A to that line of action is indeed 0.5 meters. And that's all I need to know for torques. So that's kind of neat. If I were to calculate the torques about A, by choosing A, I eliminate tension 1 from torque consideration because its line of action goes right through that point. It has no moment arm. So I only need to consider tension 2, which has a moment arm of 0.75 meters, trying to make this thing rotate counterclockwise, which would be a positive torque, because if I rotate counterclockwise about point A, then I'm going to have my thumb pointing in a positive Z direction towards you. That's a positive torque. And then I have the weight, which is trying to make this thing pull down with a moment arm of 0.5 meters, and that's trying to make it rotate clockwise, which would be a negative torque, because for clockwise rotation about point A, my thumb would be pointing into the page in the negative Z direction. So I have a positive torque balanced by a negative torque. Net torque is zero because the thing is not rotating at all. And solving for tension 2, I have tension 2 will be equal to 0.5 divided by 0.75, or 2/3 of the weight. The weight is 100 newtons. So tension 2 is 67 newtons. So there's using torque consideration to solve for the tension in one of the cords. Say I want to find tension 1. One thing I could do is choose a different origin to calculate my torques. If I choose point B, I can eliminate tension 2 from torque consideration because line of action now goes through B, has no torque about point B. And now, my positive torque will be the weight force, which is trying to make this thing rotate counterclockwise with a moment arm of 0.25 meters. And then my negative torque, which is trying to make this thing rotate clockwise, will be tension 1 with a moment arm of 0.75 meters. Summation of all the torques about B will be equal to 0. I have my positive torque, moment arm, 0.25 times weight, plus my negative torque, moment arm, times tension 1. Solve this for tension 1. Tension 1 is 1/3 the weight. which will be 33.33 newtons. Note, I could have also used force equilibrium in the y direction, because I could have said that tension 1 plus tension 2 should equal the weight as far as forces are concerned, and that's true. 67 newtons plus 33 newtons equals 100 newtons as far as force equilibrium in the y direction is concerned. So I could have used that to solve for T1 once I knew what tension 2 was. Let's try another problem. Standing on a horizontal beam, a uniform horizontal beam of length 8 meters and weight 200 newtons is attached to a wall by a pin connection. Its far end is supported by a cable that makes an angle of 53 degrees with the horizontal, looking at the figure. If a 600 newton person stands 2 meters from the wall, find the tension in the cable and the force exerted by the wall on the beam. All right, there's a lot going on here. We have tension in the cable. We have a beam that has weight, and we assume that the weight, the mg, is acting at the center of mass of the beam. So that would be right in the center of the beam, 4 meters from either side of the beam. We also have the weight of this person standing on the beam, 2 meters from this end. And then there's going to be some kind of reaction force at this pivot, which we don't know what that is either. So there are four forces acting on this beam. The thing we want to do first of all is indeed to make a free body diagram of the beam. So let's do that first. Here's our free body diagram. We got the beam and we have our four forces. We got the weight of the beam acting right at its center, 200 newtons going down. We have this person's weight, which is 600 newtons, and that's also going down, and that's 2 meters from this end over here. We've got the tension going up like this at a 53 degree angle. And we've got some reaction force, which I've written as going at an angle this way. And the reason I have to have my reaction force bent inward like this is because I know that force equilibrium must be applied as well. And if the tension has a negative x component this way, I'm going to need something that has a positive x component of force so that those x components can cancel out and give me no net force in the x direction. So I know that my reaction force is indeed bent inward to the right, as indicated on this diagram. So that's my first attempt at a free body diagram for this beam. But I really want all my forces to be x and y. That's going to help me do my force equilibriums easier, and it's going to also help me with my torque equilibriums. So I'm going to redraw my force, my free body diagram, in terms of x and y components. So it's going to look like this. So I now have the reaction force in the x direction and my reaction force in the y direction. And then I have my t, which I broke up into components as well. I have a t cosine 53 degrees going to the left and a t sine 53 degrees going up. Now everything is x and y, looking good. Sometimes I'm going to indicate my r sub x as being just, I'm just going to call it horizontal force h, and sometimes my r sub y I'll just call vertical force v. Doesn't matter. So there's my free body diagram. Now if I apply torque equilibrium about point A, what happens? Well, the reaction forces, both x and y, are eliminated from torque consideration because their lines of action both go through point A, and hence neither one of them has a moment arm about that point. Neither one is supplying a torque about that point. All they're doing is pulling or pushing on that point, and there is no transverse or rotational action due to those forces. So they have no torques. Also, T cosine 53 degrees is also radially inward to point A. Its line of action goes right through point A, and it has no net torque about point A as well. No moment arm, no torque. So the problem is immediately simplified as I eliminate those three forces from consideration to one that looks like this. About point A, I only have three forces that are causing torques. I have a T sine 53 degrees that's going up like this, and that is trying to cause a counterclockwise rotation about point A, which is a positive torque. So I have T sine 53 degrees with a moment arm of the full length of the beam, 8 meters, and that is a positive torque. Then I have two negative torques about point A. I have 200 newtons with a moment arm of 4 meters trying to make this thing rotate clockwise, giving me a negative torque. And I have a 600 newton force with a moment arm of 2 meters away from point A, and that's trying to also make this thing rotate clockwise, giving me a negative torque as well. All clockwise rotations are negative. All counterclockwise rotations are positive. So the summation of all the torques about A must be zero because this beam is not moving. It's not rotating. So we have T sine 53 degrees, moment arm 8 meters, minus 600 newtons, moment arm 2 meters, minus 200 newtons, moment arm 4 meters, is equal to zero. That's a summation of all my torques, positive or negative. And I can see I have a bunch of numbers, and T, I can solve for the tension based on this. So the tension will equal 2,000 newtons divided by 8 sine 53 degrees, 313 newtons. That's the tension in the cord as holding this beam up. How about that? Very nice. Suppose I want to find the reaction force at the pivot. Well, I could choose a different rotational axis. Let me choose point B. If I do that, I eliminate T sine 53 degrees because its line of action goes through point B. I eliminate T cosine 53 degrees because its line of action goes through point B. I eliminate R sub X because its line of action goes through point B. All those have no torques, no moment arms about point B. Hence, I'm left with this torque diagram right here. And from this, I can see I have two positive torques, 200 newtons with a moment arm of 4 meters coming out towards you, causing a counterclockwise rotation, 600 newtons with a moment arm of 6 meters, also trying to cause a counterclockwise rotation about point B, and then I have R sub Y with a moment arm of 8 meters trying to cause a clockwise rotation about point B and a negative torque. Summing up all those torques about point B equal to zero, I have 600 times 6 plus 200 times 4 minus R sub Y times 8. I have a bunch of numbers in R sub Y. I can find the vertical component of that reaction force from this equation. R sub Y is equal to 4,400 divided by 8, 550 newtons. From force equilibrium in the x direction, I should know that my summation of all my forces in the x direction should add up to zero. I've got a positive R sub X and a negative T cosine 53 degrees, and that's all I have going on in forces in the x direction. So the summation of those should equal zero. Hence, in terms of magnitude, R sub X should equal T cosine 53 degrees. T is 313 newtons. Cosine of 53 degrees is 0.6, so that is 188 newtons for R sub X. So now I know my two components for the reaction force at the pivot. So the magnitude of that reaction force would be the square of these components. Add them together, take the square root. 188 newtons squared plus 550 newtons squared. Square root is 581 newtons. And my angle would be the inverse tangent of my y component over my x component. Inverse tangent of 550 over 188. That reaction force is going up at an angle of 71.1 degrees from the horizontal. Isn't this great? So all we've added is torque equilibrium to our free body diagram, our force equilibrium that we've worked on before. And this gives us very powerful mathematical solutions to static problems so that we can solve for an unknown force. Try this out on the problems and the problem sets. There's a few more examples in the lecture notes, and there's lots of examples on EduCreations. Look at those examples, try doing them yourself as well, and become very adept at this torque equilibrium because it's a very important aspect of mechanics.